Welcome, everybody, to Sticks and Sips. This is the Drew Estate Virtual Happy Hour. I am Frankie Drinks Marino. I'm your host tonight. Back for another exciting episode. I'm glad you guys are with us. I'm going to ask you guys to check in from your neighborhoods. I love to see all those great Drew Estate people checking in from all over the globe, really. Not only parts of the U.S., but all over the globe. And super honored to have you on here tonight. We have an amazing show. So listen, let's get it started with that beautiful menu for tonight, right? This is the virtual happy hour. So listen, cocktail tonight is called the Nagata Highball. And our sips are Shibui Japanese whiskey. Our guests are Nicholas Pollacchi and Miss Allie Crozier, along with my man Joey Drew. And a stick for tonight, if you guys have been wondering, it's the Undercrown Shade Suprema. You guys have been waiting a long time for us to feature this stick. And we have a beautiful whiskey to pair with it. And listen, I'm going to jump right into the Zoom lounge and say hello to everybody. I'm going to start with my first guest. Nick, how you doing?
I'm doing great, Frank. Thanks so much for having me here, brother. How you doing?
Dude. We are super honored to have you on, man. We are super excited to talk about Japanese whiskey, but just wanted to check in with you and see how you're doing. I don't think you lack for any fluids back behind you, and we'll talk more about that in a few minutes, but thank you so much for being part of Sticks and Sips. And next up, I got Allie Crozier.
Drew hey, State. Everybody.
Allie, how you doing?
I'm wonderful. You know, it's the Drew Estate Happy Hour. How could I be upset?
It's Drew Estate Happy Hour. This is Sticks and Sips going live, man. This is our 49th, 50th episode, maybe, because we're coming up on our big one-year anniversary. So we're coming up on the big 52. So welcome, Allie. And it's a pleasure to have you on, as always. And next up, my man, Joey Drew.
What's going on, man? Good to see everybody. Good to see Allie and Nick. Nick, if we were there with you, we would put a serious hurting on that collection.
Joey, don't threaten me with a good time.
I would totally threaten you with a good time. And we've got the top shelf, too, so.
This is me just in the process of building my bunker in case I need to go through lockdown for any longer. I'm just like hoarding. People are collecting toilet paper. I'm locking down whiskey. Like, I don't care.
Priorities.
I love it. I love to hear it. I love to hear it. So listen, you know, what's a happy hour without a cocktail? So I'm going to make it really easy for everybody out there. So I'm going to call this cocktail. This is called the Nagata Highball. And I'm using the Shibui Pure Malt, which we'll have Nick tell us all about. So I usually love to do about 2 ounces. You know, you guys can
salt it taste.
Pours the way you like, you know, but I like to go 2 ounces in a nice highball glass. I use really like that hard clear ice as much as I can. I'm using a little Q. Club soda, and I'm trying to emulate how the Japanese have their lovely highballs, because this is one of the most popular ways to have whiskey in Japan. It's just that the highball is just a beautiful expression of a cocktail, but more importantly, it's a great way for someone enjoying a cigar to enjoy a whiskey. The carbonation, you know, the whiskey element keeps you going. And, you know, I've got a little neat pour here too. So I'm going to ask everybody to raise your glass. And, as we say, because we say slancha, don't we?
We say slancha van Scotland, or we say can pie in Japan.
Scotland. Absolutely. So slancha van, everybody out there, enjoy your happy hour cocktail with us. Oh man. So good. And yes, I am two-fisted drinking because that's what I do. It's part of my job. You know, you guys got to understand that. So, but if you're out there in the world and you're sitting at home, beautiful way to experience your whiskey, a little neat pour, a little highball. And we'll talk about that in a second. I'm going to welcome my next, you know, our premium guest here. So not only is he the co-owner of this beautiful whiskey brand called Shibui, founder, and he's the co-executive producer for the Dram Good Laddies, which we'll talk about a little bit later. He's a native Scotsman. He's a master of whiskey. He's been a keeper of the Quaich. Not only that, but he's also been kind of like a master of tasting and education in whiskey for brands like Macallan, Highland Park, Glen Roths, Balvenie. He's been featured on CNN and on Fox. So you guys may have come across him over time, you know. And without further ado, I'm going to welcome my man, Nicholas Pollacchi. Welcome.
Frankie, thanks so much. It's an absolute pleasure to be here. And what an introduction. I think that this is what I want to send my mother, because for 20 years, she's been like, what the fuck is it that you do? And now I can just send her this and be like, there you go. Frankie Danks, nailed it.
There you go. Anything for mama. Absolutely. You know, we got to pimp it up, man. But you have a long, long legacy with whiskey, and we're so excited. So give us a little bit of background beyond what I talked about. I just touched upon a few points, but tell us how you got started in the business.
So, thanks very much, Frankie. It's I've been in the whiskey business for about almost 20 years, you know, 18, 19 years. And actually, funny enough, I had a conversation today with a chap that kind of helped get me into the business. I worked in bars and restaurants when I went to university to study law and politics. So you can imagine my parents were delighted when I said, I don't want to do this anymore. I want to go and drink. which I think is the majority of people at that age in Scotland as well. And when I, you know, ran bars and did fun stuff for a year or two and traveled and did all that other stuff. And then I got a job offer from the chat that I spoke to today to go and work for Bacardi. So the first job I ever had in the booze business was working for Bacardi Rum. And it really introduced me to whiskey, because I was a young guy anyway, but at the time in the UK, Bacardi looked after Glenmorangie, and it was the first whiskey that I got to kind of get my teeth into and learn about single malt, learn about whiskey, and learn about production. And I just got so excited kind of doing that. And very quickly after, about 3 or 4 years later, a job came up at Edrington Group. So Edrington Group owned Macallan and Highland Park and Glenrothes and a few other different things at the time. And I was completely and utterly unqualified for the job. And I ended up looking after the global PR for their malts. And it was just the most fun. Like, if you can imagine, like, who doesn't want to go and talk about Macallan? Who doesn't want to have that? Who doesn't want to go and talk about Highland Park? Like, if you want something cool. And then if you want to go and talk about, like, these kind of quirky, small batch vintage whiskies like Glenrothes had at the time, it was just so spectacular. And I was really, really delighted to go and do it. I learned a lot. I kept my mouth shut, which was very difficult for me, and kept my ears open, which was a little bit easier. and I just learned a lot about whiskey, and it stemmed this passion of like the opportunities around whiskey. And I moved to the States to work for Balvenie. So again, working for Macallan, working in Highland Park, where do you go from there? Well, you go to the United States and you go and you work for Balvenie single malt, and to work for a family-owned Scottish, one of the few still Scottish family-owned distillery companies, and with William Grant and Sons. And it was just brilliant. Like, it was, you know, I know we all have a lot of mutual friends in the business, and it's a small world, you know, the Scotch whisky world and the cigar world. You know, they work hand in glove, I often think. We're always talking to the same people. It's the same customer. It's the same enthusiast. It's the same aficionado and appreciator. And it was really cool to do that. And then in 2012, I decided I want to branch out and start the Whiskey Dog business, which I did. And, you know, work with, you know, literally hundreds of different whiskies from around the world, consulting and doing private events for corporate clients. I was lucky to be made a keeper of the Quaich, which is this, you know, kind of secret club in Scotland, effectively, that kind of honor people who have dedicated their life to Scotch whisky. And at that point, it was really nice. And Then I was doing consultancy doing work on CNBC, looking at whiskey as an investment and other things like that. And it was just a fun time to be in the world of whiskey, I think. And then, you know, with what we have with Shibui, I did some work where I was consulting with some amazing people, in particular, the two sisters, the OIND Beverages. So we're a woman-owned company, a female-owned company. And these two fierce sisters, you know, Lauren Simmons and Rachel Simmons, were like, we want to start with wine and then we want to look at other spirits. And when they started to look at other spirits, they asked me to come on board as a partner to look at whiskey. And of course, being Scottish, the natural step there was for me to look at Japanese whiskey, which is what we did. And that was it. It was like a lot of fun. Like we're like, okay, let's look at Japanese whiskey because there's so much fun stuff going on in Japan that most people don't really get to hear or see. And don't get me wrong, we are looking at Scotch whiskey. So that will come down the line. And it's something that I've spent most of this week looking at and talking to some of my amazing friends back in Scotland. And we will be launching some Scotch whiskey, if not this year, then very early next year. But for us, Shibui was really this dream of, and it took us 3.5 years of tasting through whiskey. So I think we went to about 1,400 different cask samples to choose 9 different whiskies from 4 different distilleries in Japan. And for us, that's the fun part, isn't it? Because most Japanese distilleries or most Japanese brands, they own their distilleries and it's one brand and that's what you get. And it's great. And, you know, we're spoiled for choice. There's amazing whiskies out there. But for us, we wanted to look at what would happen if we treated the world of Japanese whiskey a little bit closer to the world of Scotch whiskey, which means we need to find a way to make Japanese distilleries work together, which doesn't happen. And that's been one of the most fun parts of what we do, is that we really have amazing partners. And because we have amazing partners, we are producing and finding whiskies that we think really step up to the plate and showcase themselves as being great sipping whiskies, great for that highball cocktail that you've got in front of you. I'm glad that you're double fisting. You can't fly a plane with one wing, so good for you. and yeah, that's it. Like, that's the story of me in an anaphylactic nutshell.
That's a part.
For everybody that's watching out there, that's not a background. That's not a Zoom background. So I'm going to ask you to prove it, Nicholas. Prove that it's not a background.
By choosing a bottle off the shelf and necking it for speed?
Okay.
Yeah, I wouldn't get with it.
Again,
yeah,
I've become your Vanna White. Look at the green tape. Like, it's all my cables for my mic are green. That I have full green screen for another part of my office for the stuff I do with Dram Good Laddies, which is all smoke and mirrors. But this actually is all live.
Oh, so, there you go.
Different whiskeys.
So for everybody,
this is a real battle.
Watching, yeah, this is real. This is real. Nicholas, how many bottles are back there behind you? And if you could broadcast your address for us.
It's Frank Moreno. it's, I think we've got, give or take, around about 1,600, I think. It varies depending what the week's been like. If it's been a tough week, it's usually sitting down about 1,300. If it's a slightly easier week, then it can grow up a little bit. In all honesty, I love all whiskey. You see, like I'm a whiskey drinker with a work problem. I have bourbons and American whiskeys and some great kind of weird and wonderful stuff. I've got some amazing Japanese whiskeys from not just our own brands, but from Yamazaki, from Nika. We've got stuff here from Ohishi and from Fukano, and then there's a whole back catalog of Scotch, as you can imagine. So
there we go.
All washed down with NASCAR beer.
There we go, because that's, you know, listen, we all have to enjoy the way we want to enjoy it. And, you know, this has been a big episode, as people have asked us, Listen, why is Japanese whiskey so popular? But I'm gonna dial that back a little bit. So tell us a little bit about Shibui, because that's really why we're here, right? We want to learn about this beautiful brand, and then we'll talk about the popularity of Japanese whiskey. So take it away, my man. Tell me about Shibui, that beautiful story.
Thank you, sir. So with Shibui, we started to look at Japanese whiskies, particularly because there's a really interesting history around Japanese whiskey. And also, I want to say whiskey that should have been Japanese whiskey, but they kind of got in their own way a little bit. And I don't mean that as a slant. I just mean that as in that was the natural progression for what happened at that time in history. So it's a bit of a weird history lesson, but basically, all whiskey is based in agriculture. So in Scotland, we grow wheat and we grow barley. So the farmers who grow wheat and grow barley would produce basically moonshine. They'd make an alcoholic spirit to have a tradable commodity when there was a bad harvest. So say there's a bad crop year, they'd have moonshine. Ah, fine, we can sell it. But trust me, in those days, you had one of two options. You'd get blazing drunk or you would die. That was it. It was a flip of a coin of what was going to happen. So not quite the refined spirits that we're seeing out of Scotland today. But that was it. That was most whiskey has history in agriculture and farming. And then in Scotland, people in England were buying the whiskey. People in Spain, people in France were buying the whiskey, and we used oak to transfer the alcohol from point A to point B. Lo and behold, you get it to the end destination, and it was golden in color. It was softer in flavor. It brought in flavors from the oak maturation and saturated it into the liquid and made it more palatable, made it more easy to drink. And of course, the light bulb goes on and we start to look at oak maturation. It's the same story in the United States. The crop of the United States is corn. So it made sense that the corn became the grain of choice. Moonshine was made with corn. Eventually, oak maturation comes into place. Different mash bills start to come into place to add depth and character. And then you end up with moonshine going into oak, giving its natural influence. And you end up with bourbon and American whiskies. It's really, really fun. And in Japan, the grain of choice in Asia is rice. So rice alcohol is starting. So people know sake, people know soju, but the oldest spirit in Japan is actually created in Okinawa, and it's called awamori. And most people don't even know what awamori is, but basically it was a rice grain spirit that was distilled into a higher alcohol level. And then it was predominantly then stored in clay pots in awamori caves. Some of these clay pots would age from 200 to 300 years old. In World War II, those awamori caves were predominantly destroyed. But it left an opportunity for these distilleries that have been around since, you know, a long, long period. You know, one of the distilleries that we work with is established in 1840s, you know, 1846. So really, really interesting that they then started to distill back into the rice alcohol, get that high distillate alcohol, and then put it into oak, which is what we have for Okinawa range of Shibui. But there's a kind of slightly rewritten history right in the middle of all of this, which is in 1918, a chap called Masataka Takatsuru left Japan, came to Scotland, spent 2 years in Scotland, learned how to make Scotch whiskey, came back to Japan and said, hey, we're doing this all wrong with rice. We need to start doing what's happening in Scotland because the whiskey's excellent, which it was, because they've been doing it using different techniques and different stills and all these other things. So instead of Japanese whiskey taking on the characteristics of the grain and the cereal from the continent and the land that's around it, it basically copycatted what was going on in Japan, in Scotland, and very great flattery, and then refining some of the processes. So they started to help create these major distilleries. You know who they are, an amazing, amazing whiskey producer. So Suntory. So Masataka Takatsuru worked with Mr. Tori and helped kind of create Suntory Group. And then he left and created Nikka. So the number one and the number two whiskey companies in Japan were basically all formed around the reproduction of Scotch whiskey being made in Japan. So the barley and the wheat was brought in from Scotland. The stills were produced in Scotland and shipped to Japan to distill the grain. The locations for the distilleries were chosen to replicate the land of Scotland. So it's a really interesting look at what the history of Japanese whiskey is. And they're fantastic. Like, they make great whiskeys. But to me, I'm really excited. We have, like I said, the two ranges. You know, pure malt for us is from Niigata, which is much more in keeping with what we're currently talking about with these whiskies. We're using 100% malted barley, or for a grain select, we're using 100% wheated whiskies. But these are world whiskey blends for us. And the reason that they're world whiskey blends is because the one thing that didn't come out of Scotland to Japan during that time was the fact that Scotch whiskey distilleries have survived and then thrived purely on the fact that we all work collaboratively. We buy and we sell and we trade casks so that we can create blends, so that we can blend whiskey. And the art form of whiskey making really lies in the master blender. Like, the blending of whiskey is massively important. If you have great spirit and great distillate and great oak, but your master blender doesn't really know what they're doing, then it's going to affect the final flavor of the product. So for us, it was really important to be a liquid-led business. We wanted to start by finding great whiskey. And it didn't matter to us where the whiskeys were really coming from. And what I mean by that is we wanted to almost go in blind. We weren't going to be prejudiced by, oh, it's from this prestigious house or it's that. We tasted 1,400 different cask samples. We went through a ton of different stuff. It took us 3.5 years to whittle it down to the 9 whiskeys that we've released. 3 of them from one distillery in Niigata. And we have our grain select, which is 100% wheated whiskey, which is distilled and matured in Niigata. And then we blend in the distillery there, blend in world whiskey, predominantly from, in fact, exclusively for us, from the lowlands of Scotland. So if you can't buy domestic whiskey for blending in Japan, because no other Japanese distillery sells to each other, they don't work collaboratively the same way we would in Scotland, then for our blending purposes, you need to look at international whiskies. So that practice has been massively common for 90 years. What's not been common is the transparency. So the number one thing that you'll find with Shibui is that we tell you everything. Go to our website, shibuiwhiskey.com, and you will see play-by-play every single whiskey, what's in the glass, the distillery, the grain that we use, the fermentation process, the maturation process, the types of oak that we're using. So it's a really fun way for us to look at whiskey and be excited about not just what we have in Niigata, which is the pure malt 10-year-old, and the grain select, which is 100% wheated, but also what we source from Niigata with 3 different distillery partners who are helping us by shaping the whiskies that we like to the flavor profiles that we wanted, but also working collaboratively on the type of blending and the cereals that we're using to create things that they'd never thought of before. So we're ending up with this real fun process of single grain rice whiskies from Okinawa, as well as some pure malt that we've got coming out next year, and some other blended whiskies using different cereals from these distilleries that are now working in partnership. So it's real fun.
Listen, that was amazing. What a plethora of information we've received from you, but I kind of lost you after we had to try 1,400 different samples. And, I would like to put my name down for the next round of trying 1,400 samples.
Frankie, it was a really difficult day. It was a really, really difficult day, I'll tell you that.
Amazing, amazing. Listen, I'm going to ask my man, Jack, throw up that beautiful graphic of Shibui, so everybody kind of gets to see a little bit of what it is. And I'm having this beautiful pure malt, and I'm going to ask you about it, because as it's sitting in the glass, it has, and we're going to something brand new over here. We're going into our little, bottle cam. So everybody that's watching is getting not only this beautiful bottle of pure malt, but all these beautiful little samples that we have of the grain select and the 10-year, the 18, and actually a little bit of the 30, which you guys don't need to look at because that stuff doesn't exist. It was only for us to try. But I'm going to ask you a couple of questions about this beautiful pure malt, because the beautiful cacao notes, man.
I'm actually going to pour
it. So amazing. So delicious. Joey, I don't know if you're picking that up, man, but
it's like that dry cacao, or but I also get like there's a stony quality to it as well. Yeah. Like rain on rocks, and I really love that. You know, I like rain on rocks. It's like, you know, it's that petrichor type, if people will use that word. It's just an interesting flavor note on the nose.
Joey, I'm absolutely stealing that. That's like, that's a great way to think about it. Like rain on rocks. Like there's chocolate and coffee, and there's an almost like a walnut note on this.
Yeah.
And then that kind of rain on rocks, the earthiness, the kind of umami, kind of like mushroom note that sometimes comes through. And it's just a great balance of dry and sweet, and kind of like, it's one of the things that for all of Shibui whiskies, and like I said, it's myself, it's Lauren Simmons, it's Rachel Simmons, it's Brett Lugo, our amazing designer, and we all sit down and taste everything collectively as a group, and we go through every cast sample, and good, bad, and ugly, we kick the tires on it, and for me, you know, we went through lots of different kind of pure malt whiskies, like lots of kind of world blends, as it would be. And this was one that just absolutely jumped out, because it's first and foremost, it's an award-winning distillery in Niigata that just have a great reputation for what they do for their own brands. And we wanted to have a partner that was committed to excellence the way that we are. You know, we actually have, as a logo, we believe in barrels over bullshit. Like the quality of the whiskey, this is 100% natural color. All Shibuis are 100% natural color. Like, even if it's light in color, at least the color that you see is because of the interaction between the spirit and the wood. So there's no smoke and mirrors. There's nothing, no trickery. There's nothing that you need to try and, where is this all coming from? Everything for us is just to be, I like that, Joey. That's nice. Empty glass.
But look at that ass.
Oof.
Look at that. That's a beautiful thing.
That's how you do it.
That's a beautiful thing. Nicholas, I'm going to ask you, what has caused the appreciation over the last few years of Japanese whiskey? All of a sudden it came to the forefront, and
Bill Murray,
really a world leader on a world whiskey. So how did that happen? You know, what was it? You know, what did you do? You know?
Personally, I did nothing. What the market did was really interesting. So, I'll start by saying this, the innovation for whiskey, I often feel, predominantly comes from Scotland. The refinement can often come from Japan and from Asia. And we've seen that with Cavalan from Taiwan. We've seen it with Nika. We've seen it with Suntory Group and Yamazaki and some of the great distilleries that they have. And I think that we've seen it now with Shibui and the distillery partners that we have, which is they are massively focused in Japan on quality of whiskey. And the reality of it is a couple of great things happened. Japanese whiskey was definitely in the United States for a long period of time before it took off. What helped it take off is really, I think, a handful of great awards that were awarded to, rightfully so, to some amazing distilleries for great expressions of whiskey. You know, some of the most best known whiskey writers globally were recognizing Japanese distilleries and their teams for their blending, for the distilling purposes. You know, they use multiple yeast strains to produce multiple flavor profiles. A lot of, because they don't sell and trade barrels the way that we do in Scotland, some distilleries have multiple sizes and shapes of stills to create flavors and differences and nuances that they couldn't get
if they didn't do that, because you would rely on another distillery to sell them that type of flavor profile. And I often talk about the world of blending is almost like being, it's like being a composer, a conductor to an orchestra. You know, the master blender's job is to choose each cask, each barrel of whiskey, like a musician. Each musician needs to play in harmony with the next musician. So that's the best way to think about a master blender. And in Japan, you know, because of the way it's set up, a lot of these amazing composers and amazing conductors don't have the ability to choose every musician that they might want to. So they have to look around. And I think that what we saw with the boom of Japanese whiskey, specifically here in the United States, but as well in other parts of the world, was this real appreciation for the master blenders and the ability to create flavor in-house by being innovative with yeast strains and distillation methods that you just wouldn't see in Scotland. And I think that's really fun. And that's the thing that I think is really to be honored and appreciated by the amazing people in Japan that dedicate their lives to creating spirits as exceptional as this.
Well, I think for anybody tuning in and wants to really dive in into Japanese, and I know that they're harder to get, including Shibui, but if you have an opportunity, go visit Shibui on the internet. You get to see their offering and get to see what is available in your area. And I'm a fan of the pure malt, man. Because I know we can't get to 30. We won't talk about it.
You can buy it. So what's really interesting about us is, and this is the thing that I think really makes Shibui stand out, our single grain whiskies from Okinawa, we are super unique. We're using premium indica long grain rice. We're using indigenous black koji from Okinawa. We are using stainless steel pot still, single and double distillation pot still, depending on the three distilleries that we partner with. And then we use a variety of different oak barrels. So we're using Manzanilla and Fino sherry casks. We're using virgin white oak. We're using ex-bourbon casks and just, you know, getting some, you know, really interesting flavor profiles together. We have an 8-year-old sherry cask. We have a 10-year-old bourbon cask. We have a 10-year-old white oak, which is European oak, virgin European oak. So it's not had a seasoning in it before. Really spectacular whiskey from Masahiro Distillery. We have a 15-year-old that is arguably one of the best whiskies I've ever had in my life. Our 18-year-old from Kumison is spectacular. And then we have a 30-year-old from Masahiro as well, which is just ridiculous. It's just very limited. So when you'll find our 10-year-olds, hopefully you'll find our 15 and our 18-year-old readily available. Go and speak to any good liquor store and tell them to bring it in if they don't already have it. But if they do have it, you know, if you're looking around, but then we have a 30-year-old. 30-year-old is really interesting because we bought everything that the distillery had, everything. When we tasted it, we're like, holy shit, this is incredible. And we will we released batches of it this year. We'll have a little bit of 31-year-old coming next year. And then we will not have that whiskey for another 10 years. We're right, looking at so a 23
you've got my
and a 24-year-old
right now. You've got my address on the 31. I'm just saying right here. I am thoroughly enjoying the experience of Shibui. And for everybody out there that wants to experience the beauty of Japanese whiskey, what a more pleasurable way to get introduced. And Shibui has an enormous, what I call like options for you. And Nicholas, I'm going to say thank you for not only sharing that, but, you know, inviting us into your home. Where we will descend upon maybe in a couple of weeks and your 1400 bottle, collection will be depleted, sir. Just letting you know.
I am happy for that to happen. I strongly believe that whiskey is for drinking and for sharing. I don't think whiskey makes a great moment. It acts as an exclamation point in an already great moment. So Frankie, Joey, Ali, getting to hang out with you. This is the great moment. The fact that we get to share some Shibui and have a drink while we're doing it, that's the exclamation point on the already great moment. So cheers. Thanks for having me here, Frankie.
Slanchava.
Slanchava.
I will say for everybody, man, what an amazing... My highball is almost done, but here's a moment you've all been waiting for. You know, she is our territory manager for Eastern Pennsylvania and parts thereof. You know, she finished her sandwich and put on lipstick just for this show. And welcome, Ali Crozier. How are you?
Well, thank you. That was a lovely introduction as well. Cranky Dranks. You're not Cranky Dranks tonight.
No, I'm not. This is my show. And one small piece from my notes is I left out Leather Fanatic. You know, that piece, I'll let you explain.
Well, when you put it like that, I definitely have to explain. I am a leather worker. I found that as a female cigar smoker, there wasn't a lot of products that were marketed towards females that were respectful, is the word I'm going to use, because I've been drinking and language is hard. So I decided a couple of years back, I bought an old motorcycle. So I'll take you back to the beginning of my leather working times. I bought an old motorcycle and I hated the way the seat looked. So I decided that I would teach myself how to reupholster it, which turned into me learning how to do many other things with leather, including making purses that hold cigars. So that when I go to visit shops as a territory manager, all I have to do is sit in the car, put all the cigars in the little slots, my iPad, my notebook, my business cards. I had a slot for everything because I was able to customize it. And that turned into making really a bunch of different things. And if I had known you were going to say it, I would have grabbed the shoulder holsters that I make. But I was at Cigar Fest one year and I was watching all these guys just like looking for an ashtray and went, why don't they make something that you can just put on your belt for your ash can? So I did.
Nice.
Because that's kind of what I do with the leather working. I think, oh, there's something that doesn't exist. Let me just make it. So
there you go. And if somebody's doing it to like, you know, chew and stuff, they can just be like a little side saddle spit tune.
Exactly. Right. Yeah. So instead of carrying around the bottle, you can keep your bottles totally fit in there because it's about, you know, beer sized. So that's one of the few items that I've made recently because quarantine has certainly given me plenty of opportunities to make some really random stuff. Looking around here, like, do I have anything else at hand? No.
No, because you got put on the spot, unprepared by the host of this show.
Yeah.
And that's what he does to you. He just catches you off guard. That's what he does.
Exactly. I do my background research and and with that, because that's my catchphrase, right? There you go. One of the beautiful things that we're going to celebrate tonight really is our Undercrown shade. Right. And tonight we're actually featuring the Undercrown Suprema Vitola, because I believe this is one of like, I love this shape. I love the way it smokes. And with the Shibui, I think it has like this beautiful balance of flavor. Right. We'll start. Jack, do you mind showing up that graphic for our Undercrown shade? So we're talking about Ecuador, Connecticut shade, cigar, Sumatran binder, Dominican and Nicaraguan filler. So it is a, Joey, it's really not a, you know, it's not a light bodied cigar, man. It's just full flavored, you know? So, you know, trying to get people to understand that flavor and body are two different things, and it's been really hard because the industry is like kind of locked down on like, you know, medium bodied, full bodied, you know.
Yeah, what is strength? I mean, you know, because strength is different to everybody. Body and flavor are different for everybody, so it is a little difficult to sometimes you know, pin it all down into something that's, you know, oh yeah, that's what it is. At the end of the day, it's just a great cigar. And look, it's coming up on just before 8 o'clock here, and a shade is fine at 8 o'clock at night after a day full of smoking, you know, some heavy leaf Maduro stuff. It doesn't matter the time of day. Everybody would like to say, oh, a shade in the morning with my cup of coffee. That's perfect. But you know what? End of the night with a nice Shibui Japanese Scotch whiskey works just as well. You still get that same, you know, that same thing that you're looking for, that that relaxation, that enjoyment, and it's about spectacular stuff. I know, Ali, you're burning down on yours pretty quickly, as am I.
Yeah, I was watching as we're both smoking. I think we've smoked the same amount of the cigar.
That's crazy, because you guys almost started at the exact same time. You had that beautiful ash, the beautiful way it's burning.
Pacing ourselves, you know.
Right.
Pacing ourselves, sticking and sipping.
And Joey, because Ali doesn't have our beautiful pure malt here. Joey's enjoying his beautiful pure malt. It's that beautiful flavor, right?
Yeah.
And so we're actually getting what I would call under a medium, right, in body, but not under a medium in flavor, because you're getting all this blast of flavor. And much like a Japanese whiskey, which I to me, and especially Shibui, it's very sublime. The flavors come to you. It's not overwhelming. It's not in your face. It's a matter of enjoying them, enjoying the aroma, enjoying how they hit your palate. I'm enjoying it as a highball and as a neat pour as well. And yeah, just I definitely love
neat is the way, man. Neat is so great with the shade. And I'm also tipping on the 18-year-old, which is really, this one's really different.
Yeah, don't talk about that, because no one can get that.
So much more.
No, Nick doesn't want to hear that. But
it's yummy.
But the beauty of it is getting that full flavor coming in, you know. And Ali, listen, I know you've been a big proponent of Undercrown Shade for a long time. And you know, what is it, you know, for everybody out there? Because, you know, they're always like, you know, why should I pick up an Undercrown Shade? And that's a big, you know, the big thing, you know, when you're at a store, and we haven't been there in a while, but, you know, when you were there, when we introduce people to Drew Estate, is why do we go there?
So the reason that I enjoy this cigar is actually a lot of the aroma. So I smoke for aroma, not just flavor. You know, try to use all your olfactory senses when it comes to cigars. Cigars touch all your senses, period. You know, the seeing, tasting, feeling it, you know, when you listen to a cigar to see if it's just right and ready to be smoked. You know, some people call it squeezing the Charmin, but... You know, listen to the cigar. It'll tell you if it's ready to be smoked or not as well. But I smoke for the aroma of it. It doesn't accost my senses. It's a very creamy cigar, but at the same time, it was the first cigar that, you know, when people are like, oh, nuttiness, you know, what's nuttiness in a cigar? This was the cigar that explained that to me. I have a nut aversion. I shouldn't eat peanuts or almonds. Things happen. It's fine. I don't die. I'm here, aren't I? But it was, I've had them before. So when I smoked this cigar and went, oh, it tastes like almonds, but it doesn't taste. It's right at the back of your senses. It kind of feels like almonds in a way. It's hard to explain, you know, for newbie smokers, when I'm trying to teach them how to retrohale, because that's also an important part of the process, in my opinion. You know, learning to retrohale a cigar and learning what an impolite retrohale is versus a polite retrohale. We've talked a lot about that.
Could you tell us a difference, please?
A difference between a polite retrohale and an impolite retrohale. As the story goes, an impolite retrohale, you need a safe word, but they're not going to listen. So you go to retrohale the cigar and it just slaps you in the face and it makes you cry and it feels like it's coming out of your ears, but you enjoyed it so much and you go back for more. And it still does it. And you're like, why am I doing this? And you're crying, but you love it. That's impolite. And the exact opposite is a polite retrohale, where it's just smooth and it just levitates with you. That's a very polite retrohale. And this has a polite retrohale.
All right. So I'm going to ask Nicholas, you know, because at this moment he's crying.
I just Nicholas, wanted to...
if you have any questions, this is the moment.
question is, what happens when your safety word is don't stop?
That is an interesting safe word, Nicholas. Then you just keep retrohaling the whole time. And that's the other thing about retrohaling is it does change just like the cigar changes. I feel like the cigars that I really enjoy are going to change on you a couple of times. So I'll retrohale in the beginning of the cigar in that first inch and see where we're at. Do I have to safe word or not? And as you go into the cigar, it's that, oh, don't stop. That was really lovely. And then you just keep finding those moments within the cigar and seeing where the retrohale takes you. Cause it maybe you get the nuttiness in the middle of the cigar on the Suprema. Maybe you get it at the end of the cigar, but what is the retrohale telling you? So it's listening to all of those little bits and bobs of the cigar. That's really fun. So clearly I have fun smoking cigars.
I love it. I love for it. Everyone I think it's on and thank you. I'm learning today. I'm learning. Because up until this point, I thought retrohale was just an old school weather report. So now I'm
no.
So for everyone on Facebook, listen, as you're enjoying your cigar and you're enjoying your retrohale, mucus and tears are indicators of where you are. That's where I'll leave it. So enjoy as you can. Nicholas, I'm glad you're learning, because I'm learning as well that there's safe words and unsafe words, and there's safe words you don't need to obey.
Only with cigar.
Only with a cigar, absolutely. Listen, Ali, this is what we're about. It's sticks and sips, not chips and dips, and not anything else. This is where we're living. So,
agreed.
So Ali, above all things, you know, we invite people to join us right into the Drew Estate world. And we often invite them into Undercrown Shade as the entrance into our world. And what's that invitation like for them? You know, what can they expect?
Well, besides again, that nuttiness and creaminess, that you're going to get a cigar that's not, how do I put this? It can be complex if you're a more experienced smoker. So it's a great starting point for anybody that wants to start with traditional, but doesn't kind of know where their nicotine tolerance lies, then the Undercrown Shade is a great starting point because it's very flavorful and it can be complex if you know what you're looking for in a cigar. But as you go through it, it just sort of builds on you. And like you said, it's not quite a mild cigar because when you have, you know, you definitely have to classify it as a Nicaraguan mild cigar because there's mild Dominican, mild Honduran. This is mild Nicaraguan. So still super flavorful, not going to kick you in the nuts with strength, which is always sometimes pleasant.
No, right. It's never pleasant to get kicked in the nuts, ever.
Right, listen.
I can tell you.
Metaphorically kicked in the nuts.
Okay.
Listen.
I think it still hurts.
Hoya Antonio Corojo, 1970 Corojo, that's a kick in the nuts.
Well, the dark Corojo
may not be there for you, but there's nothing worse than introducing a cigar smoker who's new into something that they're not ready for. And the Undercrown Shade has always been a beautiful way to introduce people into that line. Joey, I'm gonna ask you. I mean, you've been around this brand from its inception. It's a beloved brand. Brother, you know, speak on it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, born on the factory floor, that's where it all begins. You know, everybody knows that's the story of how that happened, you know, with our cigar rollers on the floor making their own blend. Now we came out with the Maduro. The Shade is the first one that Willie was involved with, working with the team, and you know, really just challenge. I mean, it's like, you know, it's that collaborative thing that Nicholas speaks to, and that's what Drew Estate is. And it's how we collaborate within, we collaborate all around us all the time. And so that was a collaboration with Willie and the team in Nicaragua to make this cigar and really make something that stood out, that really showcased the quality of cigars that we can make, you know, that stand alongside any other cigar that's out there, period. End of story.
And at the time, we didn't really have too many mild options in the Drew Estate portfolio itself. You know, collaborating with Nicaragua, we did, but.
Yeah, no, we were doing, we had a lot of Mexican Maduro, we had all the heavy leaf Liga. You know, so everybody was all of a sudden like, oh, we only make this, but here we come out with that. You know, everyone, oh, and from a business standpoint, look, a Shade cigar is the larger selling, you know, wrapped cigar in the country. So, you know, as a company that's making cigars and we like to sell cigars, well, let's make one of these and let's make it the best. And that's really what we did with Undercrown Shade. And it's great. And the Suprema, what a fun size. It puts out so much smoke for a Shade. Shades aren't known really for big monstrous smoke, but man, this.
Joey, tell us a little bit more about the Suprema. I'm going to ask for that slide right before you get to this, because just a beautiful, not only just the vitola itself.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
It's unique.
Yep.
And it's beautiful. A
classic, it's an old classic Cuban size. They've been made for 100 years. You know, some people would say it's a perfecto. Sometimes in the larger sizes from that same shape, but larger would be like a diadema. But a figurado is more classic. And it's like, again, one, it's fun for the craftsmanship part. Man, what a bitch. You know, you can't make a lot of them really quick like other cigars if you're making Toros and Robustos. Making that shape cigar takes a, you know, super trained, skilled roller, you know, to put that together.
You know, you already have to be skilled.
Nicholas, pay attention, Nick, because I'm giving you this one for free. All right. We're going from a certain ring gauge at the head to a fatter ring gauge by the foot. And then we're actually tapering that down to a point. And that beautiful way that the cigar roller is wrapping that wrapper and giving us what they call the four faces of that cigar is absolutely perfect. And I think a name like Suprema, you know, fits the cigar wonderfully because every face of that cigar is fantastic. You know, for the old Cuban rollers, right, Joey? You know, they said, listen, there's one part of that cigar that looks amazing. And then that's where we put the band so they can see the perfection and less perfection on the backside or whatever they chose. But the beauty of a Suprema is that, my God, this is a beautifully perfected cigar. And it's a beautiful expression of what we do. And listen.
Let's drink to that.
Let's drink to that. You know, listen. I completely forgot because Nick got me off my game. You know, he's got like those thousands of bottles behind him. And I'm like, I'm out of whack here. So this is the Drew Estate Virtual Happy Hour. Frankie drinks, sticks and sips. You know, you guys had your questions. These guys are trained already. You know, they're super trained to ask the real questions, right? So everybody out there, you put in your questions. Thank you so much. And but before I get to your questions, I'm going to say this. It's Mezcal Minute.
It is.
My right-hand man, Joey Drew. So Joey Drew, take us to Mezcal Minute.
Mezcal Minute. I haven't been sipping any Mezcal tonight because I've been enjoying this whiskey. It's been amazing. And the 18-year-old is phenomenal. It's so floral. It's just, man, knocks your socks off, man. Delicious stuff. But
Nicholas, I'm taking the last bits.
The last
bits. Pay attention.
Look at that.
I'm taking the last bits today because I haven't had any.
It's yummy.
I think I deserve it.
But Mezcal,
I deserve it.
Just a shout out to our friends at Ojo de Tigre who were on last week's show. We have a little bit left in the bottle, so I'm going to keep this away from Ryan Rayford, who apparently Ryan Rayford can't hold his mezcal. We know how that went. If anybody saw that.
No, yo, listen, that man can hold his mezcal.
Yeah.
One man, one bottle.
One bottle. He was down.
One evening. That's all I got to say.
So this is great stuff. Great. You know, we talked about a lot of entry level type of stuff. This is great entry level for you if you find it. Also great for people, you know, look, if you're, you know, drinking a lot of mezcal like I do, excellent as well. It's a fantastic blend of two different varietals of Espadin and Tobala. Super flavorful, and jump down the rabbit hole, as we like to say. Ojo de Tigre, mezcal minute. Peace out.
There you go. You got your mezcal minute. So let's get to the questions tonight. These are amazing. So these next names, you guys get like the Sticks and Sips cutter. You may get like this beautiful hat. You're going to get some extra swag, and we're going to take care of you. So Joey Cleghorn, ask Frankie Drinks, but I really do believe this is ask Nicholas Drinks. Oof. Do you think the elevation and map coordinates of Japan truly make their whiskey comparable to Scotch?
Whoa.
Just watch that.
You know, I'm going to pour myself another highball because this answer is going to be out of this.
I need to look at Google Earth now after that.
So there goes.
Here we go. I like it. Challenge accepted. So it's an excellent question. And the answer is yes and no. There are parts of Japan where the climate massively replicates what would happen in Scotland. So Niigata, close, a little further north, closer. So, and let me call it like the main island, like the main island areas of Japan that people are kind of familiar with. But when you look at where we are with Okinawa, it's night and day. So there are parts where, you know, the distilleries that we use and partner with in Niigata are closer to the climate, four seasons in that part of Japan. The summers in Scotland are not notorious. If you want to know when summer is, it's on July 3rd between 4 and 5 o'clock. So you can come and enjoy it in Scotland. It's an amazing, amazing time of year, amazing hour that we have of summer. But in Japan, obviously a little bit hotter, a little bit longer, but there are four seasons. However, in Okinawa, not so much. So you go Okinawa, if you look at it map, and you do, if you look it up in Google Maps, you need to zoom in because it's this tiny little island in the southwest part of Japan. It used to be the Ryukyu Kingdom. It is closer to China and Taiwan than it is to kind of the main larger islands in Japan. And the climate is subtropical. So completely, exactly like Scotland, subtropical palm trees, you know, the rest.
We're all out there. Scotland.
As we say in Scotland, taps off, you know, get your top off, out in the sunshine. It's barely 28 degrees. Oh, the sun's shining. Here we go. But no, in Okinawa, it is subtropical, super humid, lots of warm air. And that's exactly what we need. The humidity and the warmth makes the barrels act like the lungs, effectively. Barrels of whiskey are like lungs. So when it gets warmer, so during the daytime, so let's talk about it through a 24-hour cycle. During the daytime, at heat period, the barrel, the wood expands out like any other piece of wood. You know, and then at nighttime the wood contracts and that pushes the color and flavor from the oak back into the whiskey. And this is happening over long periods of time. The maturation process is effectively acting like a lung. But the interesting thing about all whiskey, it doesn't matter. The age of a whiskey tells you nothing. It only tells you how old something is. It doesn't tell you how good something is. What we're looking for is maturity. And maturity and age are two different things. And I will prove it. Barrels of whiskey are like human beings. And I'm sure everybody out there, thanks for tuning in, knows a 30-year-old who's just a jackass. And you also know a 30-year-old who you want to go and hang out with and have a glass of Shibui, a glass of beer, a beautiful mezcal, whatever it happens to be, right? Both are the same age, both are different maturity levels. And it's the same. Like I often talk about whiskey like children as well. Has anybody ever spoken to like a 5-year-old girl and a 5-year-old boy at the same time? It's a different conversation. Speak to a 5-year-old boy, he's like running into walls and eating mud. Speak to a 5-year-old girl, it's like speaking to the CEO of an international corporation. She's going to tell you what she's up to that day, what's going on, and why you're bothering her with your like infantile questions. Like, what's going on? Like, stop wasting my time, I've got things to do. And both are the same age and both are different maturity levels. And that's the same way to think about whiskey. But as a climate, Japan lends itself to both. There are areas of Japan that, you know, the cold winters, the snow-capped mountains replicate what goes on in Scotland. A little bit more four seasons in one day. And then there are parts of Japan that give us completely different flavor profiles. And that's the exciting thing. And that's why we have two different regions. It's why we have our Niigata range with our grain select, with a pure malt and a pure malt 10-year-old. And it's why we have our Okinawa range with our single grain whiskies from that part of Japan as well. So we're doubly blessed, but yes, we have both.
Well, listen, thank you, Nicholas.
You wanted a one word answer, didn't you?
No. Yeah. Listen, Ali's all excited. I'm all jealous. Whatever.
I'm dying.
You know, she's dying over there. Yes. She's making that drive over to Morristown. So
don't tell people where I live.
Jason Ledger. Yeah, she's doing like I drove all night. She's doing a Cindy Lauper. So Jason Blanchard asked Frankie Dranks, where does your passion for mixology come from? History and the reality, it comes from guys like Nicholas, their passion for their brands. You know, I kind of came into the in this industry into the passion for people representing their brands and people representing what they want to do with those brands. They wanted to take something spectacular, and you know, I call the term gild the lily. You know, they wanted to elevate it. And in that, they dug into the books from pre-prohibition, and they pulled something beautiful from those times, and they added a beautiful spirit to it. And that's kind of where my passion is born, from authors, from people like Jared Brown and Cuban Cocktails, where he's kind of digging back all the way, from Dale DeGroff, who's digging into kind of the first guys digging back into the Prohibition era cocktails, pre-Prohibition era cocktails, to the world of mixology that paid respect to spirits before Prohibition. And they were giving a lot of love to amazing brands. And, you know, listen, I'll throw you one.
He's going to try to make an answer as long as Nick's. I know it.
You know, so Coqui Americano, right? Where we're talking about how we introduce a modifier, which was mildly introduced into the world as Kino Lele. And in this day, our closest thing to that modifier is Coqui Americano, and how we introduce that into cocktails and how we're bringing that passion back into another world. You know, and I will just say, how can you not fall in love with that? Because that's the beauty of spirits. It's the beauty of cigars, where we're growing something amazingly agricultural. But it's all about the experience and whatever going into your mouth. To be crude, it's going into your mouth, and it's becoming part of you. And you know, how could I not share a passion for that? So thank you for that beautiful question. I've got another great question. Bayliner asks, and this is to Nicholas Dranks, right? Ask Nicholas Dranks. Do you use koji yeast when making Japanese whiskey?
Oh, that's an excellent question. So I'm going to keep it short because I know that I get paid by the word. So I talk. Evidently, Joey's calling me out for it. Thanks for that, Joey. What I would say is don't let the truth get in the way of a good story. So all joking aside, so for when you, I'm going to give you the geeky answer here because I think it was a kind of cool geeky question. The geeky answer is this. When you want to create alcohol using barley or wheat, you go through a malting process, and the malting process creates the enzymes that help convert starches to sugars. When you do that with corn or with rice, you don't malt any of those grains. You use hotter water, and then you use koji for rice. And koji is effectively a mold that is folded into the rice when it's got hot water in it, and it creates a saccharification process on the enzymes that help convert starches to sugar. Now, most distilleries will use, if you're making sake, for example, you use white koji, or if you're making soju, you'll use yellow koji. But basically, the original, everything is like a transformation of the original koji, which is indigenous Okinawan black koji. And we use black koji for our single grains in Okinawa, but we're using malting for our Niigata range for the whiskies produced there that are using wheat and malted barley. So yes, we use koji, which effectively creates, funnily enough, it's a mold, you fold it in, and then you add yeast into that process through the fermentation. But the koji creates like a, almost like an umbrella, like it creates a barrier to bacteria. And black, indigenous black koji produces a massively high citric acid content, which is forcing flavor into the rice. So for us, it's not about producing rice whiskies that are really light and delicate. Our rice whiskies are like jamming, like they're packed full of flavor. And that's what we want. That's what we want Shibui to separate from the pack of the rice whiskey world. We want to talk about being super flavorsome and creating this abundance of different things going on. And I think Frankie mentioned it earlier, like it's not one dimensional. It's not one big flavor hits it. Like it's not a big sherry bomb, or it's not like a big smoke monster where it gets like getting slapped by a Boy Scout. This is like, we want everything to play together nicely in the sandpit. So we've got lots of things going on, but very subtly. And so there's lots of flavors, but not one thing's trying to be one dimensional. And I have a feeling that that's a perfect match to the cigar that you guys are smoking, because as you go through that smoke, it changes. You know, the tapering, all these flavor things create different flavors as you go through it. And that's the same thing for Shibui. The first time you sip one of our single grain whiskies, you're going to nose like banana Foster's or grilled pineapple or the sweeter notes. And as you continue to nose it, then you're going to get the umami, the kind of mushroom notes, the earthy notes, the rain on stone, as Joey would describe it. Like, and I think that's what's pretty cool. Like, there's lots of things going on, but not all together.
By the way, he's a bitch for calling out rain on stone. That was probably my shit.
No way.
For way back, but whatever. You know, I'll give it to him because he's my man.
Yeah,
you
know,
Frankie, I don't know if you know this, but Rain on Stone was the name of my first band in high school. So just a fun fact.
Yeah, my first band was called Slowly Decomposing. But that's another thing. Thank you, Ali. She's been having, she had a great time with being slapped by a Boy Scout. I'm watching you, girl.
Hey, the Boy Scouts founded by a guy in Scotland, so.
Oh, my God. I'm
dying. Oh, my God. This is going off the rails so fast. Anyway, Chad to Chad. Really? Chad to Chad. Congratulations. You are the next winner on Sticks and Sips. Yeah, everybody's just checking out right now. As Frankie drinks, and this, Nicholas, this goes to you, man. Crack your next pour or beer or whatever.
Oh, what's that one?
What's the Scotland's everyday man's drinking whiskey? Wow. So what does, you know, is it Shibui? Is that what every Scottish
depends what man from Scotland you're talking whiskey? To? This particular Scottish man is super excited about Japanese single grain rice whiskies, and their Nagata World Blend whiskies, but. But honestly, like I'm as you can tell, I am
just a little, just a wee bit.
Yeah. I don't discriminate when it comes to whiskey. I think you need to really work hard to find bad whiskey these days. We're spoiled for choice. Like there's some great Irish whiskeys coming out. Amazing. I'm a massive fan of Canadian whiskeys as well. Super underpriced, super underappreciated. Fantastic category to get into. Great whiskeys, Wiser's 18-year-old. If you just want like a great go-to under $100, Wiser's 18-year-old Canadian whiskey is a fantastic drop. Gosh, what else have I got here? I love Balvenie. Like I love Balvenie. I like Glenfiddich is another distillery, obviously owned by the same family. But Glenfiddich is one of these companies that people overlook because it's such a big distillery. And same as like Glenmorangie. Like Glenmorangie, people go, oh, Glenfiddich, Glenmorangie, Glenlivet. Like there's a reason they're the number one, two, and you know, the biggest distilleries in the world. Like they don't make bad whiskey. They make exceptional whiskey. And Glenfiddich in particular do a great job of innovation. I think Glenmorangie are doing some fun stuff. I've got a bottle of cake back here. I had a bottle of Glenlivet 14-year-old cognac cask that was killer. Shout out to some American stuff. I've got a bottle of Wyoming whiskey down here. If nobody's tried Wyoming whiskey, go and buy a bottle of Wyoming bourbon. It's killer. Absolute rock star. I've got some stuff here from Westland, from Woodford, High West, and then, you know, Jefferson's, Elijah Craig, Hill Rock, another great one. I'm E.H. Taylor, for those of you that want to talk about Pappy Van Winkle till the cows come home, go and buy some E.H. Taylor. Do yourself a favor. Great in the price point and just really delicious whiskey. So good for you.
That's amazing. And if anyone knows the Balvenie and you know Neil Strachan, who's been on with us before, you know that you need to go get yourself that week of Pete because that'll make you really angry. And you go out and fight somebody in the parking lot like Joey did last week. Next, Brain Dead Ed, really? Ask Frankie Dranks, to any of you guys, what do you say is the biggest difference between single malt scotch, and I'm going to assume single malt scotch, and Shibui? You know, Nicholas, I'm sorry. This goes back to you, man. So what's the major difference between single malt scotch and Shibui?
It's a great question. So single malt scotch, single means one single distillery. So when we talk about Shibui single grain, we're talking about one single distillery as well. So it doesn't mean one barrel or one batch or whatever. It means the distillery is just numero uno. Then when we talk about the cereal, when you talk about malt, you're talking in Scotland, you're talking about the cereal grain. So it's 100% malted barley. For us in Shibui, when we talk about a single grain, our grain is 100% premium long grain indica rice. Okay. When you talk about, our world blend, so the whiskey, the Shibuis that we have from Nagata, they're closer to blended whiskies. Because we're blending whiskey from one distillery in Nagata with one distillery in Scotland, but it's still a blend. It's a pure blend. So it'll be 100% wheat or it'll be 100% malted barley, but it's still blending those flavor profiles together. So in short, 100% malted barley whiskey from Scotland is one distillery doing 100% malted barley. The closest thing that we have is our single grains, which is why they dominate the price points and command the age statements that they do, because they're aged exclusively in that one distillery with 100% grain from the continent, which is Asia, and they grow rice. So for us, that's the closest comparison of what I think real Japanese whiskies should look and feel like with rice whiskey.
Amazing. And I'm going to go, that pure malt is amazing. Joey, you know, you've had it tonight with me.
No, it's super yummy. It's such a beautiful blended whiskey. Yeah, it's beautiful. It's very reminiscent of a lot of the brands that you've spoken to already. You know, from Scotland, it's in that same wheelhouse with a little extra, just a little extra, something that is right. Unique to itself. So that's where that one comes from. But I'm partial to that 30-year-old. Jesus.
Yo.
Wow.
You need to stop because we've got like about 1 ounce left.
Yeah.
And after this show, it's gone. So, listen, I'm going to thank my guest tonight, Nicholas Pollacchi from Shibui, sharing an amazing amount of knowledge with us. Thank you, Nicholas.
Frankie, thanks so much for having me. It's been a pleasure to share the panel with Ali, Joey, and yourself. It's like you guys are rock stars for everything that you do, for the passion that you have for your cigars and for the spirits industry, Frankie. This is killer. Thanks a lot, man. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much, Ali. I want to thank you for being amazing, as you always are, for laughing at my jokes, because you always do. And I will say that hits me here because, you know, that means a lot to me. You know, listen, we'll trade addresses with you and Nick and you can, you know, do your thing. But thank you so much for being part of Six and Sips. And my man, Joey, listen, 1,000 fucking episodes or whatever it is, right? 50, 51, 52, 49, whatever it is. My man, it's been with me all the way. Slanchava to you, my brother. You know,
I got a shout out. May 6th, Drew Estate Maniacs. May 6th, make sure you're there. Freestyle Live is coming. We got some really sick shit to drop on you. Fuck yeah.
Oh, hell. Yeah.
I'm not saying nothing about May 6th because they've got a show May 5th. But on May 5th, I'm going to say some shit. So... stay tuned, right? But we got a big Freestyle Live coming up. And listen, tonight's been amazing with Shibui Whiskey, with Undercrown, Shade Suprema. So thank you to everybody. Most importantly, there's a slide. No, not that one, dude. What? What happened to support your local brick and mortar? So, you know, it's like, hey, look, support your local brick and mortar, support your local bars, because those guys are taking, you know, are waiting to take care of you as we come out of COVID. Take care of those guys. You know, they've been waiting to take care of you for a long time. And I'm going to say cheers to you guys.
You need a refill.
You know, yeah, it's time for a refill. Listen, everybody, Drew Estate Cigar, thank you so much. Follow us, Drew Estate Cigar, Frankie Drinks, do your thing. But more importantly, tune in next week. And we got Tequila Ocho, man. How bad could it be? It's going to be freaking delicious.
Oh, yeah.
Trust me on this one.
Get your
salute to everybody. Listen. Catch you next time. Bars closed, man. Tip out your servers. Tip well. Do your thing. See you next week. Cheers.
Good riddance.
Out.